Hello and welcome to a very special edition of Midnight Launch News, because every edition of Midnight Launch News is a special edition. I'm David, and I have a very special guest here, and special guest, why don't you just go ahead and introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your YouTube channel?
I will gladly introduce myself. My name's Franklin, and I have a channel called Will the Beard Reviews. Not Will the Beast, Will the Beard Reviews. We talk about movies, comic books, and talk about all the DC TV shows on the CW. And I'm very happy to be here to be Dan's subpar replacement for this week.
Subpar replacement. You're an American, Dan's a Canadian. That automatically puts you one notch above him. And
indeed it
Dan, I hate you so much. You're on the beach somewhere, sipping daiquiris, relaxing, playing with the dolphins.
Damn it, Dan.
And it's raining here in Dallas. And you know, I think it's been raining since the day you left, Dan. When you leave me, everything is just rain. But that's beside the point. So today we're going to be talking about video games. But more specifically, movies based on video games. Are they good? Are they bad? And why, either way? Franklin, I'm going to give you kind of the first bat at this. What do you think overall about video game movies?
So I think for the most part, they have a really bad track record. There has yet to be a great one. There's been lots of attempts at great ones, and lots of people have thought that they've come up with the great one. I think, you know, watching the news coverage of the last couple big video game movies, Warcraft and Assassin's Creed, both of those, you know, news cycles were like, oh, is this going to be the video game movie that's finally great?
Right.
I think you pulled the list, and we'll probably go through it later.
Oh,
but
we will.
Yeah. I don't think there's a movie on there, on the video game movie list, that is truly great. There are some good ones and ones that I definitely enjoy, but I don't think we have yet to get that one that is the genre-defining video game movie.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. So, for this video, you watched the Warcraft movie.
I did.
And you watched the Assassin's Creed movie.
I did.
And I watched both of those as well. I immediately regretted watching the World of Warcraft movie. As some of you listening on the channel may know, I'm big into World of Warcraft. I've been playing since vanilla, since the very beginning. And I had intentionally kept myself away from the movie because I thought it was going to be terrible. And, you know, despite being someone that plays a lot of World of Warcraft, I'm not necessarily the target audience for the World of Warcraft movie, because I play World of Warcraft for the gear, for the challenge of the fights, for the mechanics, and I could not care less about the storyline or the characters or anything like that. So I went in and I watched the Warcraft movie, and I almost didn't make it through the entire thing. I almost turned it off.
I will concur with that. I mean, I know nothing about the world of Warcraft, the game. I mean, I know it's a massive multiplayer online, and I know that you have the Alliance and the Horde, and you go, you know, you do your raids and you gather your gear and stuff like that. Just general cursory knowledge.
Right.
But as far as the lore that the games are based on and the history of it, I really had no idea. So I was really interested in seeing if the movie was some sort of Lord of the Rings-esque kind of fantasy adventure epic, and what I got was a seemingly low-budget cartoon.
It was an epic failure, in my opinion. It was an epic.
It was.
A sort of an epic. I thought it was just terrible. Low-budget is, it's a really good way of summarizing my feelings for the film. I felt like everything just, God, it felt like it was done by like a student or something.
So,
like, it just didn't feel clean.
So I will say, and I said this in my review on my channel, that the CGI for the orcs and a lot of the magic stuff, that I actually really enjoyed.
Mm-hmm.
But I think where the movie visually fell down was like the costuming and some of the set design. It felt too bright. It felt like brand new. It didn't feel lived in. And like I said a minute ago, it felt cartoony.
So this is kind of like the whole episode 1, episode 2 thing where everything just looks a little bit too shiny. Right. You're like, wow, that's supposed to be a starfighter. It should probably have some battle damage on it. Like, certainly it's hit an asteroid or two while it was running, you know, the Kessel Run or doing whatever it was doing. And it doesn't look like that. And it kind of takes you out of the experience because the rest of the world, they do a good job of making it look lived in for the most part. So your environments, your cities, specifically the orcish cities that they build once they get over there to Azeroth, that all looks relatively lived in. But then you see the characters and you see their armor and you see, you know, some of the creatures like the armor on the horses, et cetera, et cetera. And it just looks absolutely pristine. Like they had just, you know, created it and then put it on and said, here you go.
Right.
And it, there's kind of a little bit of a disconnect there. I definitely, I'm right there with you on that, without a doubt.
And just to be clear, I said low budget. Like, part of, like, the human stuff felt low budget.
The acting felt low budget. It did. Like, for me, there were just, look, when you watch a movie, there are going to be, for the most part, in any given movie, there are going to be cringeworthy moments.
Yeah.
And, you know, that just happens. Like, one or two in a movie, you kind of just forgive it, you move on, and maybe it momentarily takes you out of the experience, but you don't have any problem just falling right back in to that suspension of disbelief that is so necessary for enjoying movies. In the World of Warcraft movie, like, it was cringeworthy moment after cringeworthy moment after cringeworthy moment. And by the time you get to the next one, you're still trying, like, you're still taken aback from the first one, and now you've got this one, and you're thinking about that one, too, and you're just, like, the entire movie, you're just, like, thinking about, did he really just say that?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, the entire movie, you're just reeling from the cringe.
Yeah.
And, you know, the sad part is, the studio spent $160 million on that movie.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah, and clearly all that money went into the visual effects of, you know, in a CG somewhere.
Or, but, you know, I don't know how much of it went to Blizzard for the property.
You know, that's, I don't think, and so when I say $160 million, that was its production budget. So that's how much it cost.
So that's
to make the movie. So
that
doesn't
include, like, royalties paid or
that
securing
would,
the rights to the IP.
Right.
Like that. Okay, so that's on top of that,
so,
like, $160 million.
None of the marketing, none of the rights to, you know, the studio's going to buy the rights from Blizzard to make this property.
Right.
Things like that. Or, you know, points off the back end, however little money the movie made, to give back to Blizzard. That's just
It made surprisingly successful, like $568 million.
Not
but
that much. No,
that,
it was.
Let's look it up real quick.
It was. I think it was like $460 million. Only like 10% of that, which was here in the States. So it found its audience somewhere overseas.
In China.
Yeah, in China.
Yeah. World of Warcraft is absolutely huge in China. So that's where, from what I understand, most of the money came in from. We'll have that number here in a second. Once the good old internet figured, $433 million in the box office.
Yeah.
So $160 million budget.
Yep.
And you said that probably does not include marketing.
No.
Marketing is probably like another $160 million. Like,
usually,
I feel like
when I'm evaluating the financial success of a movie, I take its production budget and double it. And that's how much a movie has to make to at least break even.
Break even.
So this movie had to make $322 million, maybe break even, once you factor in marketing cost and theater cuts, because that number is just a gross. That's
right.
How much, you know, money it took in at the box office. That's not how much the studio actually brought back on it. So this was, I wouldn't say a financial failure, but I would definitely say a financial disappointment.
Yeah. So coming from someone that's played World of Warcraft, and that has honestly been playing the Warcraft franchise since, you know, Warcraft Orcs and Humans, I don't think this was a good video game movie. I don't think this was a good movie, period, end. Like, it just wasn't good.
Yeah.
And I assume you feel the same.
I definitely feel the same. As someone who evaluates movies as a hobby, I didn't like this movie. There was a point where I was watching this with my wife over the weekend, and there's a point near the end where a lot of the action stuff was happening, and paused it to get a snack or go to the bathroom, whatever. And I looked at the runtime, and there was a half an hour left, and I was just like, oh my god, there's half an hour left?
The movie is like 2.5 hours long. I told my wife when I was done watching the movie, I was like, this movie felt like it was 4 hours long.
Yeah.
And feels like it only should have been 1.5 hours long,
yeah.
But ended up being 2.5 hours long.
It was ridiculous.
Like, and from what I understand, there's like 40 minutes of cuts that didn't even make it into the movie.
Probably.
Thank God.
Yeah.
Thank God. You would have had people walking out of the theater. Now let's move on to Assassin's Creed.
Okay.
What do you think of that movie?
This one I actually really enjoyed. The way that I put it in my review was, it's the kind of movie where I wouldn't pass it up in the bargain bin, but I'm not sorry I missed it in the theaters.
Mm-hmm.
For me, it's kind of the perfect lazy Saturday night movie, kind of almost throwaway action movie, mm-hmm. that has enough lore and story in it to keep me engaged and keep the action being more than just action.
I was absolutely smitten by the Assassin's Creed movie.
I absolutely
loved it. I had such a fun time. I have played a lot of the Assassin's Creed video games, but the lore within the video games and the stories within these video games is just so nebulous. It's hard to keep track of. It's spread over so many video games that, for the most part, when I have played them in the past, I've basically ignored the storyline and just went in for the action, for the combat.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoyed the storyline for Black Flag. But even within the Assassin's Creed video games, you have sort of split storylines within each video game. So you have the Abstergo out of the Animus storyline with a character, and then you'll have the inside the Animus character, which is where the bulk of the gameplay is, where, you know, you're a pirate, or you're in the French Revolution, or you're in the American Revolution, so on and so forth. So I always felt like I was missing something. And I feel like the Assassin's Creed movie did a really good job of taking an extremely complex, possibly an overly complex storyline, and condensing it so that people that maybe that are like me, that have played the video games but did not dig deep into the Abstergo Templar / Assassin side of the whole lore, could understand what was going on and make it easily available to viewers that have never even heard of the IP.
Mm-hmm.
I thought the action scenes were absolutely amazing. I absolutely loved what they did with the Animus, where it kind of goes from inside the Animus to the exterior of the Animus, and you see him like fighting the shadows or
yes,
the ghosts.
That was really cool.
I thought that was an absolutely great effect. And it's funny because I'm looking at some user scores here for just some information I pulled up. Looking at Metacritic, for example, Assassin's Creed has a 36 critic score and a 63 user score, whereas Warcraft has a 32 critic score and an 82 user score.
Interesting. So I want to talk about that, just kind of a quick segue. When it comes to critic and user scores on online rating systems, I usually take critic scores from Rotten Tomatoes and mm-hmm. user scores from a website called CinemaScore.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that's, you know, come up recently in the news with a lot of the controversy around Rotten Tomatoes and its audience rating with the DC movies and the recent stuff with Black Panther and that, you know, right-wing extremist group wanting to, you know, tank the score, it's clear that user scores on some of those websites aren't exactly
legitimate.
But yeah. CinemaScore is a service that actually has people in theaters polling audience members as they come out of the theater.
Okay.
So it's as close to legitimate as you can get. I looked it up, and Warcraft had a C, which in my mind was generous, but mm-hmm. Assassin's Creed had a B+, which was...
I can see that.
Which is right where I would be.
Yeah, I would be B+ or A-. Like, I just had a good time
yeah.
watching Assassin's Creed. And you know what? Sometimes that's all you want in a movie. You don't want a overly complex storyline with a whole bunch of character building. You just want something that's easy to understand.
Mm-hmm.
You want a clear motivation to drive you through the movie. And you just want to be able to sit back and enjoy the spectacle of it all.
Yeah. So I have a question about that. So Warcraft, the movie, was kind of clearly trying to fill in the history of Azeroth and the Horde and all that, kind of give the backstory of everything. Is there a specific game, one of the Assassin's Creed games, that the movie was based on? Or is it just
it's more of a generalized...
general kind of amalgamation.
Amalgamation of a lot of the movie. Like, okay, so the Apple of Eden, or whatever, that is basically one of the driving forces throughout all of the video games. And then, of course, the Templar and the Assassins fighting their, you know, basically war that lasts forever. So, it's definitely not based off a single video game. The World of Warcraft, I call it the World of Warcraft, the Warcraft movie, I believe takes place... I want to say, like, at the very beginning, like, Warcraft, Orcs and Humans, I think.
Yeah, because the Alliance wasn't formed until the very end of that movie. I think most of the fighting in that movie was between humans and orcs.
Yeah. I want to, like, talk about the Warcraft movie, and I want to be like, man, I enjoyed it, and I want to be, like, this lore geek, because I've played this game for so long, and I know the series. But as someone that does not play for the lore of the video game, you know, I just pretty much always ignore it. So a lot of these, you know, you look at this 82 user score for the Warcraft movie, and I kind of assume that these are the people that really, really, really enjoy the lore within the Warcraft universe. These are the people that caught all the inside jokes and the inside references, that saw that character with a ponytail and an axe and was like, oh my god, that's that guy, and oh, we did this with him, so on and so forth. For me, one of the reasons it didn't work out for me, beyond me just not being fascinated with lore, and this is something that I wanted to bring up and something for us to kind of talk about, is I think when you look at a video game, I think one of the primary reasons that people play story-driven video games is the power fantasy. You get to be someone that is more powerful than yourself. You get to exert influence in situations that you normally would not be able to, and you get to build upon that. And I think that is something that is extremely intoxicating to people. Everybody wants to, you know, play their own power fantasy. I mean, we see this in more than just video games, but we're going to talk about it in video games here. Even within World of Warcraft, for example, every time you go on a quest, they're like, hero, we need you to do this because you're the only one that can help us. And Thrall and all these other people are currently doing other things. So, you know, the world depends on you, so on and so forth. And then you try to turn that into a movie. And that power fantasy, that one element that drives a lot of people through these video games, just completely disappears.
And I can completely see that. And that kind of brings up something I wanted to talk about, kind of along the same lines. I think both video games and movies are experiential. With a video game, you get the experience of spending... for like a story-based game like Assassin's Creed, you spend, what, 50, 60 hours in this game with your character, walking through the story, you know, step by step. And then in World of Warcraft, you live in it for, like, what, 20 years? However many years. And then
more years than I want to admit to.
Yeah. And then when you go see a movie, you spend, you know, hour and a half, 2 hours, 2.5 hours in that world living with those characters. And just like a video game, the most powerful movies are the ones that an audience member can see themselves in. And so, you know, it when that makes that translation, if a game enthusiast that loves a game like Assassin's Creed or Warcraft goes to see the movie and they can't replicate that experience there, it falls down for that video game lover. And then if the movie tries to recreate the video game experience that is lost on an audience member, it falls down for the audience member. And I think a lot of video game movies fall in a crack trying to serve both worlds when they're better served of making the movie, kind of like Assassin's Creed was. We both enjoyed that, and I think it's because that movie spent most of its time establishing its story and telling the story rather than trying to replicate an in-game experience.
Yeah, yeah, and there were definitely parts within the movie that were homages to the series. You know, there was a lot of parkour, and parkour is something that basically Assassin's Creed almost like invented within video games. But it was definitely... It didn't feel like it was trying to shove these things down your throat the entire movie.
It felt natural.
Exactly. And that, I think that's what makes it so good. I also wanted to bring up another thing beyond the power fantasy, but sort of ties into it. I think when you're a gamer, there is a sense of agency that you have when you play a video game. You get to make your own choices. You get to make your own decisions. And you expect those choices and those decisions to have consequences. And even when it's not a completely open narrative title, even when it's sort of a closed narrative where, yes, you're controlling a person, but this person also has their own personality, there are times when, as a gamer, you will imprint upon that character. And that character will make a decision in the game where you might not necessarily agree with it. It might not be the first decision you would have made, but you will go through the mental gymnastics required to make that decision that was made by that character kind of mesh with what you would have done.
Interesting.
And that is something that, once again, is completely lost in that transition from a video game to a movie. That sense of agency, that sense of making personal decisions and imprinting what you would do, or your emotion, or your moral compass upon that character. That's something that has gone from movies. And I think that disappoints a lot of gamers, because one of the reasons that I think a lot of video games resonate so well with their audience is because the developers and the publishers, a lot of their work is already done when it comes to trying to tie the character's motivation to the player.
Interesting.
Okay, like, it's already done. We don't need to do much. We just, this is your character, right? He's going to have your motivations, and so long as we give you a storyline where you can conform your own thoughts and your own motivations to this character's actions, then we've got you invested.
Mm-hmm.
In a movie, you can't really do that at all.
Yeah,
I just dumped a lot on you.
Yeah,
like, I've been thinking about that for a while. Go ahead, take your time,
man. Yeah, that's a whole lot of time. Oh, let me take that one. Yeah, I can definitely see that when you've got this character that you're spending so much time with, you're bound to get invested in it emotionally, even if it's from a story-based game, and definitely in like a more wide open world like Warcraft or something like that. In a movie, you've got, you know, 2 hours to spend with that character, maybe more if it's a franchise film or there's sequels or things like that. But, you know, if a character makes a wrong choice in your mind, or a choice that you don't agree with, it could ruin the movie for you.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and you're not trying to go through those mental gymnastics to make those character decisions work, unless you just really love that character, or if it's from a property that you like, things like that. So,
right.
You know, I think movies, in this discussion where you have that kind of agency over your character, video games compared to movies are a lot more fragile.
Yeah, I completely agree. So let's go ahead and just look at some of these scores, and we already went over this a little bit. I was going to pose this question when we started this show, but I guess I forgot about it, but now we'll look at it. So we kind of went into this going under the assumption that, for the most part, video game movies are bad. I pulled a ton of Metacritic scores, and I found something really interesting. So, the average Metacritic score for all movies, across all of Metacritic, from a critic perspective, is a 64. From a user perspective, it is 57.
And that's for all movies, not just video game movies?
For all movies.
Okay.
For all movies. Now, we go and we look at some of the video game movies. And for this data set, I pulled both of the Mortal Kombat movies.
Okay.
Prince of Persia, Sands of Time. All six of the Resident Evil films. Both of the Tomb Raider films. Need for Speed, Dead or Alive, Assassin's Creed. Both of the Hitman films. Doom, Warcraft, Max Payne. And both the Silent Hill films.
Okay.
So the average user score for the video game movies is 66.5. And the average critic score, this is where there's a massive change, is 35.
Ooh.
So critics, like users, rate these movies on average a little bit higher than they would rate just some IP that they've never heard of, by about a delta of about 15%. And then critics. Man. Critics go from 64 down to 35.
Wow, that's pretty interesting. That's a definite split.
That's a huge split. Like, man, that is so, you know, the question is, are the user scores all scores from people that already enjoy the series and they go to see the movie and they're under the predisposition to enjoy the film because they've enjoyed the video games? Or are these critics being overly critical of the film based on the perception that video game movies always suck, that there's some sort of video game movie curse
that's
where
interesting.
You just can't make a good one?
That's very interesting. You know, when I will probably say that there's a lot of truth in there, and it's not one or the other, it's some of both. I will agree that there's going to be some unconscious bias in, you know, professional critics that video game movies are, you know, the popcorn fluff of the cinema, and video game movies for audiences are them seeing their favorite IPs come to life, so they're more predisposed to like those. You know, I'm a comic book fan. You have to work hard to get me to not like a comic book movie.
Sure.
And that's rare. Batman v Superman. So it's rare for someone of a fan of a property to not like it. So I can see a disconnect there. And also, when I'm usually evaluating scores, looking at the way critics review a movie versus the way an audience reviews a movie, if the critics are much higher on it than audiences, to me that says it's probably more of a higher art, more maybe an indie film, more of an Oscar bait kind of movie,
right,
that's more accessible to critics than it is general audiences. And then on the flip side, if critics are down on a movie where audiences are up on it, clearly that was designed to be just, you know, some of that popcorn fluff.
Yeah, just
or,
a summer fun movie.
Yeah.
Just
and
go,
then,
go
you know,
enjoy
if,
it.
If critics and users agree that it was terrible, it was terrible. If they agree that it was great, it was great.
Right.
So just kind of understanding that swing. So this tells me that, yeah, there's probably some unconscious bias from critics and some unconscious bias by users.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I think that's a fair conclusion to draw from what we have. I also think when you take into account this, you know, particular piece of information, you do have to question whether or not video game movies are bad as a whole, period end. Because you look at something like a 66 user rating. Yeah, you're not lighting the world on fire at 66, but you're also not an absolutely terrible movie.
Right.
You're completely serviceable at 66. You look at 35. Okay.
That's a bad movie.
That's pretty bad. But it could also be a lot worse.
Yeah.
And, you know, I look at this Mortal Kombat. I loved both the Mortal Kombat movies.
I love the first one. It's been years since I've watched either of them. I own them both on DVD. I think I bought it out of the $5 bin at Walmart, so don't take too much out of that. But I remember really enjoying the first one, and then I think the second one maybe tried a little too hard, tried to push lore a little much. But again, if I'm drunk, I'm enjoying it.
Yeah. I still think the first one holds up really well, like even today. Prince of Persia: Sands of Time. Haven't seen it.
Haven't seen it either. But I know, just as a side note, I know that movie got a lot of flack for casting Jake Gyllenhaal as a Persian.
Whew. Yeah, we're not going to get into that. Resident Evil series. Have you seen any of those?
I know those are terrible movies, yeah. At least past the first one. Mm-hmm. I know they have little to nothing to do with the games, and that fans of the game typically hate them because they are poor representations of the game, mm-hmm. but they are undoubtedly one of my favorite guilty pleasures.
Yeah?
Yeah, I really enjoy those movies.
That's wrong and, with that.
A lot of that may be driven from Mila Jovovich as the lead, mm-hmm. But those are just good guilty pleasure movies.
How about Tomb Raider?
Love Tomb Raider.
Love Tomb Raider. I love Tomb Raider as well.
The first one is probably, in my opinion, one of the best mm-hmm. video game movies. It's at least top two or three.
That's fair.
And I'm super excited for the new one with Alicia Vikander here in about 2 or 3 weeks.
Yeah, we'll see. I'm a little bit on the fence about that one. Just because of how much it actually takes from the video games. Some of these shots that we have seen in the previews are literally like shot for shot from the video game.
Interesting. So is that one? That one looks like it's pulled straight from
the first one, from the 2013 Tomb Raider reboot.
Okay.
And then Need for Speed.
Didn't see it.
I didn't see that one either. Dead or Alive. Mm-hmm. I doubt either of us saw. Nope. Assassin's Creed.
Talked about that one.
Both saw. Both liked. Did you see any of the Hitman movies?
I have not.
I have not seen that either. Doom. Did you see that with Ooh. The Rock?
Oh my God, that's some good early Rock shtick.
I liked it. I liked it. I had never liked it.
You know, that movie is ambitious. I don't think it works, but you have to give it points for being ambitious. That whole FPS scene near the back end of it. That takes some balls. Whether or not it worked, you have to give it points for that. And the movie had Carl Urban in it as well as The Rock. So two men that have gone on to do great things.
Very good things. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Warcraft, we already talked about. Max Payne, I've seen it.
See, I have no idea how it relates to the game. I remember it being okay.
You know, the Max Payne character is almost like I'd say his foil, or his comic foil, would kind of be like the Punisher.
Okay.
Sort of like an anti-hero.
That's kind of what I remembered. Like, he was out to kill some people.
Yeah.
And there were some supernatural elements to it.
Yeah, I don't remember that. Well, I mean, there's like what you could consider supernatural elements within the game, like bullet time, where he can slow down time and shoot people. But not like supernatural, like ghosts and goblins supernatural. Okay. And then Silent Hill.
Have not seen Silent Hills.
Have not seen either.
Although
of those.
One of my best friends absolutely loves the games and the movies, so mm-hmm. somebody said about that.
I mean, this list of movies that I've pulled, there are some. Well, you know, I look at it and I'm like, none of these movies, at least in my opinion, are abject failures. I think some of them miss the mark quite a bit. Warcraft. But, you know, for the most part, I think a lot of these are just enjoyable experiences, whether or not you've played the video games. And I feel like the critic scores are just, honestly, I feel like they're really low.
You know, I notice in the list of movies that you call not abject failures, you fail to mention Super Mario Brothers.
I did, and that's because it did not have Metacritic scores.
Really?
Because it came out before Metacritic was a big thing. Yeah, I wanted to add it on there. There was the Super Mario film, and there was one other film.
Probably Double Dragon, because I remember looking at the list, that one came
out. It might have been
right?
Double Dragon. It might have been Street Fighter.
I remember
Street Fighter had a movie.
Yeah.
I actually enjoyed that movie as well.
It's been forever since I've seen that one.
But yes, that is the reason those films were not on there. That was probably super loud in the mic. I apologize. It's because they didn't have Metacritic scores. But yeah, let's talk about Super Mario Brothers.
That's a bad movie.
That was rough. That was rough. I honestly, it's been so long since I've seen it. I can't really talk about it because I don't remember. Like, it's one of those movies where you watch it once and then you just kind of shove it to the back recesses of your mind that you just don't think about ever again. and you're just like, yeah, so that was an experience.
So I'll look up the date while I'm talking, but I believe I actually saw it in theaters when I was a kid. And I remember as a kid walking out of the movie really enjoying it. And I also remember some commercials for the toys that I remembered that they were enjoyable commercials. And I think I had one of the action figures.
Mm-hmm.
It came out in 1993, so I was 7. So probably the right age for a garbage movie like that.
That sounds about right.
And then I watched it again as an adult, and
yeah,
it's a bad movie.
You know, it's one of those movies, though, where you look at it and you're like, this is obviously, this movie is not targeted towards adults. So is it even fair to go back and look at this movie and try to review it as an adult when you are not the target audience?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and, you know, looking, I read trivia on this because I was curious and doing some prep for this. That movie, like, the studio wanted, like, kid-friendly family fare, and then, like, the directors wanted more adult stuff.
Right.
And, like, the directors were a married couple that continue, like, they fought on set, like, continuously.
Hmm.
Script rewrites came out to the point, like, during filming, to the point where the actors just started ignoring them. And Bob Hoskins and John Leguizamo, Mario and Luigi, got to the point where they had to just get drunk every day to get through filming.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's, I mean...
That's the kind of movie that I would enjoy, a movie about the making of that movie.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Get on that, Nintendo. We know you absolutely love doing controversial things.
Nintendo hasn't made a movie. Like, Nintendo hasn't made a movie since Super Mario Brothers.
No, it...
Like, that movie turned them off of making movies of their properties.
I think Zelda could be an interesting IP for a movie.
If I remember right from the trivia, there was a Metroid movie, like, in the works when they were making Super Mario Brothers. Mm, and when
that would be really good for a film.
When Mario Brothers failed, they were like, nope, not doing movies anymore.
Yeah, it's probably not worth it for them.
Not anymore, anyway.
Yeah.
At least not at the time. Nowadays, maybe. With the advances in movie-making technology and casting a female lead, can make a lot of...
Yeah, yeah, especially in Metroid.
Yeah.
I could absolutely see that happening. Man, I think that's about it. That's all I have to bring up. Did you have anything else you wanted to talk about?
Yeah, one other thing. We talked about, you know... And when I look at a video game movie, I think there's kind of two ways they can go. They can either explain the lore from the background of a movie or background of a game like Warcraft, or they can try to adapt one of the games itself, kind of like what it looks like the new Tomb Raider is going to be.
Mm-hmm.
I think straight adaptation is the wrong way to go, because in a 2-hour movie, you're never going to capture everything that you could in a 50 to 60 hour gameplay movie.
Yeah, or even like Tomb Raider, 20 to 30 hour on a playthrough.
Yeah. And then I think of those two, lore is probably the better way to go. But there's a third option, which I read an article. Is it Naughty Dog or Raw Dog that makes
Naughty Dog?
Naughty Dog. There's been an Uncharted movie in development, mm-hmm. like forever. And I read an article and it had a quote from Naughty Dog's representatives, and they said that as they continued to talk about adapting one of the four Uncharted movies, they became more and more unhappy with the direction it was going, and they weren't being able to recreate the stories they told in the game in the movie. But then someone came up with the idea to tell a young Nathan Drake story.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, ooh, that way we're serving the character, but we're also distancing ourselves enough from the video games that we're not relying on them. That way the audience isn't disconnected from it because they haven't played the game.
Right.
And we're also not disconnecting from the game players because we're not whiffing on recreating an experience.
Right.
So I think that's probably the best way to go. And I think that's why probably the two Tomb Raider movies with Angelina Jolie were as successful as they were, mm-hmm. because they took the heart and essence of the character and told an original story and a whole story with that character.
Beyond Angelina Jolie and skin tight clothing.
Yeah, I mean, you know, any movie.
I do agree with you. I don't know that retreading old ground is the way to do it. But at the same time, you know, a lot of the lore in these video games gets super heavy, especially when you think of an IP that's a franchise. I mean, let's bring up Warcraft again. Orcs and Humans came out in like 1991 or 1993, a long time ago. So you're looking at 20 plus years of lore between Warcraft, Orcs and Humans, Warcraft 2, Warcraft 2 expansion, Warcraft 3 expansion, Hearthstone, and then, you know, of course, World of Warcraft and its six or seven expansions. The idea that you can make a movie and try to serve fully the lore of a franchise like that, in a 2.5 hour period is just absolutely ridiculous. And I think one of the reasons that the Warcraft movie did fail is because it tried so much to get so much lore, and it was so lore dense, introducing new characters, introducing new factions, like the Kirin Tor come up at some point. And like, I think it's just a throwaway line. Like, there may be two or three lines around the Kirin Tor, which is a huge organization that plays a really large role within World of Warcraft, but it's a throwaway line in the movie. And you know, I don't know. I think lore, honestly, is probably the worst way to go, depending on the franchise, just because these games are so lore dense. It's just not
I can definitely
possible.
see that for Warcraft.
Oh, and I mean, even if we had something like a StarCraft movie, or, you know, we can look at Final Fantasy. Man, I should have put that on there. I can't believe I forgot about Final Fantasy. So Final Fantasy's had a couple movies come out. The Spirits Within.
I haven't seen that one. I don't think I've seen any of the Final Fantasy
The
movies.
Spirits Within was kind of like your third option, where you try to do something pretty different and kind of disconnected from the franchise as a whole, but maybe just pull one character over or one central ideal over so that there is a thread that connects the movie back to the original video game franchise. The Spirits Within was actually a bomb. Like, it did not do very well at all. Which was unfortunate because this was, you know, sort of Sony Entertainment's first attempt. Did I say Sony? Sorry, Squaresoft. Their first attempt at making a movie. And it was just rough. But then they were like, okay, well, this didn't work. We tried to kind of do. We took Final Fantasy in a weird direction. They tried to make it this sci-fi storyline, which is just not what Final Fantasy is. And it was not well received. And then they came out with a Final Fantasy movie that is basically a continuation to Final Fantasy VII, which is by far the most beloved of the Final Fantasy series. So it was fan service. Like,
Like
that is
legitimate
legitimate
fan
fan
service.
service. But it was really good. It was really good fan service, and I absolutely love watching it. Now, maybe the reason I didn't put it on this list is because these are all live action films, whereas all the Final Fantasy films are CGI completely from the ground
Yeah,
up.
you said The Spirits Within tanked. I looked it up while you were talking. Its production budget was 137 million. You want to take a stab at how much money it made worldwide?
28.
85 million worldwide. So,
That's more than I thought. Now, how long ago was this, though? Because that's something else we need to keep in mind.
July 2001.
This was 17 years ago.
Yeah.
We just talked about another movie that had a budget of 130 million. I don't remember which one it was.
Warcraft had $160 million
Warcraft
budget.
had 160 million.
Yeah.
So Warcraft's budget was only $30 million more than the original Final Fantasy movie's budget.
Yeah.
Yeah, it did not. The other one was called Final Fantasy Advent Children, if you want to look that one up.
The
But
other one on here says Kingsglaive.
Kingsglaive is after Advent Children.
Okay, I just put Final Fantasy into Box Office Mojo, my favorite movie money side and only came up with those two.
I think Advent Children was
it just called Advent Children?
To video.
Oh, that's probably why I didn't have it. Yeah. It didn't have a theater release. Yeah, and I wouldn't have any box office numbers.
But Advent Children and Kingsglaive, I thought, were both great movies. But those, once again, Advent Children is kind of like a sequel to Final Fantasy VII. And Kingsglaive tells the story of Final Fantasy 15 kind of in between. Like with Final Fantasy 15, they actually did something really interesting that you might end up looking at. They decided to make a Final Fantasy 15 universe where they would marry all sorts of media.
Interesting.
And that was from the start, that was their plan. So you had the Final Fantasy 15 video game, you had Final Fantasy 15 Kingsglaive, which was a feature length film, CGI. You had an anime series that was like a 8 or 10 episode anime series that detailed each of the characters and sort of some of their earlier interactions. And then, of course, you had mangas for Final Fantasy 15. Mm-hmm. And then you had some books as well.
Wow.
So they were like, we are going to blitz this. We are going to make Final Fantasy 15 not just a video game, but we're going to try to make it a media franchise. And for the most part, I think a lot of fans that enjoyed the game would look at Kingsglaive and would look at the anime series, which was really well done, in my opinion. I absolutely loved the anime series. It was called Brotherhood. And they would say, yeah, they did a great job. Like, this is video game media, video game movies, plus anime, etc., etc. This is how you do it right. You just expand on the IP that is already there. You don't shackle yourself down with already, you know, pre-existing lore, etc., etc. You just add to it. That way, like we talked about earlier, there is a thread connecting the movie to the original IP, but you're not just going over, you know, retreading the same territory
right.
and over, just trying to retell the story.
Interesting. So. I'll have to look that up. Is the media around Final Fantasy 15 accessible if you don't play the game? Like, could I watch the movie and understand the story? Or could I watch the anime and understand the story?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely. The anime is done in a really interesting fashion where you start out in a scene that happens in like episode 8 or something, and then you kind of do like the whole flashback thing,
sure,
so on and so forth. And that's how they frame that. Now, the movie is completely separate from the video game for the most part. So you've got sort of your heroes within Final Fantasy 15, which are like Noctis and his friends, and you go off on a grand adventure and you go do stuff. And while you're on this adventure, the evil empire of Niflheim comes in and takes over your home
okay.
kingdom, and they do bad things. And Final Fantasy 15, the movie Kingsglaive, is about what happens when Niflheim invades.
Interesting.
And the Kingsglaive, which are basically the guards for the king, how they try to fight back this invasion, who dies, who survives, etc., etc. So you don't actually see any of the main characters from Final Fantasy 15 in Kingsglaive.
Okay.
Which, obviously, if that's the case, you don't need to know anything
right,
about
so
it.
Right, so these events are just kind of happening concurrently?
Right, they're happening in parallel with each other. And they are referenced to each other within the game. Like, the main character, Noctis, is referenced to within Kingsglaive. And there are scenes in Final Fantasy 15 that reference the Kingsglaive and what happened to them and so on and so forth.
Gotcha.
But it's really good. Man, it's really good. I need to go watch that movie again. Maybe let you borrow it. Did you finally get a Blu-ray player?
I finally have a Blu-ray
player. You finally have a Blu-ray player. Thank God. The movie finally has a Blu-ray player.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Well, we are at 50 minutes.
Nice.
50 minutes recorded. Guys, thank you so much for joining us this evening. I would like to thank my best friend over here, Franklin, from... What's the name of the channel?
Wildebeard Reviews.
Wildebeard Reviews for coming over and kind of teaching us a little bit about movies and dropping some knowledge on my head about movies, because I, you know, I enjoy movies, but not to the extent to which he does. We will have a link to his YouTube page down below, and we will also have a link to his blog and a whole bunch of other stuff. He does great movie reviews. Extremely eloquent person within his writing, does a really good job of giving you an idea of what you're getting into without spoiling the movie or anything like that. So you should definitely check him out. And I think that's about all we've got today.
And that's all I got too.
All right, well guys, this has been David
and Franklin
and Franklin over there. Thank you so much for joining us this evening.
My pleasure.
Hope y'all, not you, them, the people that are listening.
Well, it's my pleasure that they joined.
All right, it's his pleasure that you joined, whatever. And we will talk to you guys later. Bye.